Welcome everybody. Thanks for coming down this evening for Elizabeth's slide lecture presentation. This exhibit's been up for all summer long, so this is kind of, we wanted to wait until everybody came back and the school year started and hope that we get a good crowd, and it looks like we have, so thanks for coming. It's kind of like a little bit of a closing reception. Show runs through next week, all the way through next week. Yeah, next Saturday would be the last day. And as you all know, Elizabeth's a professor of art at the University of Montana. She's a printmaker. She creates complex images, like the ones we see here, if you guys hopefully have had a chance to look at the show. But they're complex on a number of levels. I mean, just the complexity of looking into the image. Her processes are often technically challenging, and they're always conceptually rich. The physical labor, like the actual work that goes into one of these, let alone 26, and let alone multiples of all 26, is kind of hard to imagine. And in that, in Elizabeth's actual making process, it's integral to the end content of the work. So I consider Elizabeth a conceptual artist who really loves to make pictures. The work itself, the labor, the painstaking, you know, over and over, the dedication, exploration, is like I said, it's integral to the final piece. I'll let Elizabeth talk about that, because after First Friday a couple weeks ago, she gave a talk, and Brandon and I were talking afterwards, and he said, you know, Elizabeth, I think, is, I don't know what he said exactly, it was to the effect of, you know, I've not heard an artist who knows so clearly, like, exactly what she's doing, but also that can explain it, like, perfectly succinctly. So, and I agree, she really can get to the point quite well. So, we'll get it over to Elizabeth. Thanks for coming. Oh, wait, we're being filmed tonight, recorded by Missoula Community Access Television as part of a media assistance grant donated to MAM by MCT. So we'll have the video, we'll be able to put up on our YouTube page, and it will play on MCAT sometimes, so keep track of the schedule.
Introduction, and I've known John for so long, so to hear you speak so kindly about my words is much appreciated, as is this opportunity, once again, you know, for MAM to support my work. And I'll be actually going to show some slides of the adjacent room a few years ago, about 7 years ago, when a similar body of work was on display. And again, that has been a kind of consistent support, and I sure appreciate it. And this work is actually going to travel around Montana next. It was selected, Brandon and John promoted this as a body of work to tour with the Montana Art Galleries Dealer Association for the next couple of years. So it's going to go to small and large places around our state, which is intriguing to me. So I thank you as well for coming tonight and devoting some time and for being hooked enough by what you saw maybe on the surface here to want to know a little bit more. So there's enough of us maybe curiosity about this, what this puzzle might be. So I think my role tonight is to try to reward you for coming and to explain some of my motivations for why this happened. So I'm going to get into it. Do like that. Jesus. Okay. So I started this project, it took me 2 years to complete this project. I began it about 2011. There are 26 prints, one for each letter of the alphabet. They are, in a nutshell, every dictionary illustration documented and enlarged consistently and then overprinted. So that's kind of the basics. This is letter A. It's going to have 130 layers, which you can see it back below. Letter Z, ending with letter Z, just 28 layers on letter Z. So these screen prints are obviously not portraying the illustrations as separate layers as they are in the dictionary, but instead as this kind of merged graphic icon, right? And so my goal for this, I mean, the end motivation was this notion of the totality of information, specifically visual information, and how much I desired that, you know, wanted to know things. So I printed all of it. I didn't leave anything out. I think I'm going to start with talking about how I did it, and then maybe get into more of the why I did it, because the how is actually sort of a strong foundation for the why. But this is called It Started with Aardvark. This is the first illustration in the dictionary. So I photographed all of them. It's a 2,600-page dictionary. It's a tome. I mean, it's a sturdy dictionary. And there's about 3,000 illustrations. So they were each individually photographed. And then, I mean, dictionary illustrations, we'll talk a little more about this in a moment, but they already lack context. I mean, they are stripped of as much information, extraneous information as possible. And I did it further by enlarged them all, and then I screen print them. That's me screen printing the first layer of aardvark to get this. So what is obviously missing from this is the text caption. I mean, that was one thing that was eliminated, as was any sense of, you know, any other tonality. So each of these layers is just bare. It is as maybe pure a sort of form of information as I can manage to create. And I have to say, oh, here I am printing layer after layer. And I am charmed. I was charmed 5 years ago. I remain charmed by the quality of the illustrations, and the. So these things are all embedded then in the letterhead. Screen printing. Lots of labor, as John says. So this is the building of the print, layer after layer, until we get, I think that's the final one. So 130 layers. And then this is really key. So why did I bother to do this, and what is it, and how are you supposed to unpack this? I hope that this is the first clue, which is when you can see the print from this in person, close up, even with the plexi in front, I hope that there's still a surface quality which, through its specific materiality, encodes meaning. And specifically, it encodes a kind of sedimentary incremental layering. So this thing didn't happen once, is really what I mean to say. This is not a solitary inkjet print. I could have, I had to work with Photoshop to make these layers. I could have just compressed them all into one, spit it out as an inkjet print, and would have taken me a matter of weeks, you know, to do that instead of years. But the patient kind of dedication to that layering, that stamina, was really critical, I think, because what I was performing, I think what's encoded in this, what I was trying to perform, was a kind of dedication and a kind of fascination with knowledge and with learning and with exploring. And so to me, and time, sorry, and then also that this happens not at once, but it is a kind of you know, a marathon. It is an incremental dedication that is years, a lifetime really for us to know things. But this project, I hope anyway, conveys that through its surface qualities. So that's why I bothered to do all of it. So all these attendant metaphors about what that surface might be couldn't really have been created if I had done something more speedy. So, nonetheless, it took me 2 years to do this, a fairly patient work, as I said, about 3,000 illustrations. So, there's more surface quality, pardon me. I forget what I added on tonight for our slides. Surface quality, but we're sitting with the print, so you got it. All right, so where did this idea come from? And I'm gonna give you a little context, talk about some of the other projects which led up to this, including the MAM exhibit that I had. And all of this goes, or actually can be traced back to my journal, my sketchbook. And if you look just in that margin note, I'm going to zoom in on that, but it says this. It's cut up a book or a dictionary or the UVic catalog to get the text swears. And it says Bible and then divination underlined twice. So this is a brief margin note that has fueled, that probably, I know, it's absurd, it gets worse. This has fueled me since 2002. In 2001, were two events. I mean, today is September the 12th, so it was on 9/11, as well as a death in my family that was tragic and inexplicable. And both of those events, kind of back to back, certainly left me in a state of grief. And I was floundering. I was angry. I didn't have answers. And so in this fit, I was still wanting to make work. And so this is what I came up with, was the idea of cutting up a book. And I say the Bible, but I didn't pick the Bible. Mostly because the Bible isn't a place that I turn to for find answers. I'm being an intellectual person, I turn to more cognitive sources, for which the dictionary, of course, is going to be the prime sort of shared resource between me and my audience. If I pick up a dictionary, you're going to go, oh, meaning, definitions, right? we got that, we share that. So I picked a dictionary, and in my grief and my frustration and my despair, I started cutting up letter by letter. So the dictionary contains all the words, all of them, and so all of the potential meanings, if you just knew how to put them together, you could answer the questions that you had. And I understand that's a silly formula. Like I said, I understand the absurdity of that on its execution, but as a sort of response to grief, I found it solid then, and I think I still find it solid. The kind of patient cutting and trimming, I use hair cutting scissors, people like the details, the hair cutting scissors. I use those, and I'm cutting it up line by line, then letter by letter, and I called this, I was doing it page by page, and I called this digest. Technically, I suppose that project is still ongoing. I never gave it up, but I'm barely into letter B. So I just needed something else. I mean, even with my stamina, that was too much. But I think through the process of destroying the book, I was also creating something else. And what I was creating was, I like to call it text dust, which is this collection. This is probably a little, well, did I have a page in here? I'm sorry, I don't mean to be vague about it. No. So I collect them in single bags, a page of a dictionary. It's not much more letters than this. By the time you break that thing down, it's not much more. And so this notion of cutting something up and taking something logical and making it illogical is not a negation of knowledge. I fear that that may be one of the takeaways for an audience, is to think that I am opposed to knowledge, or I'm only angry. But I find that there's something creative about it, because it makes this text dust, and I've worked with that over the years, and it's almost like a pigment to me now. I've used it so often. I also think that there's a metaphor here about how, in Western cultures particularly, we deal with knowledge. We take our natural world, our universe, and we start dividing it up, right? We, you know, roll up our sleeves, and we call it biology, and geology, and dendrology, and we go deep. And, you know, put the blinders on and kind of ignore the rest. And through that execution, that understanding, you lose the, you know, you lose a big picture, even though you gain this kind of specialization. And I think that what I hope is suggested by this text, that's what I have from it, is this kind of yearning to make sense. That if you could only put those pieces back together, and I think this says that if only you could disassemble this, or in this case reassemble it, you could learn something, or you could know as well what it was trying to convey. So I hope that it has that echo more than the sheerly sort of destructive or negation. So these projects are always about a search for meaning, and I think that reassembly of knowledge is what I'm part of all sort of about. Finding out what these things mean. So while I was cutting up those pages, again, it was maybe for me, even for me, too taxing to stick with that. I made this body of work, and a few of these are actually in the MAMS collection now. Corpus of the Unknowable, corpus meaning both, referencing both body and also collection of books. And what I did here was I took individual words. I bought another dictionary, sorry. I bought a second one. Turns out they're cheap. the dictionary I picked is, someone's going to ask, so I'll get it out there. It's Webster's New Third International, 1966. It is a thick book. And when I went to find a dictionary to cut up, when I was in this state of despair, I actually wanted something that was a burden. You know, I wanted a heavy book. It's a kind of yellow ochre cover. It has, you know, beautiful indented pages, and I mean, you feel it's weighty in all ways, both literal and figurative. And I wanted something to sort of equal the kinds of inquiry that I was doing. When I was asking big questions, and I was fairly angry, and I wanted something to sort of physically echo that. So it wasn't a paperback. So what I would do is I would buy a second one, and I would only pick certain words to define. I picked 100 of them, and this one is the word language. I just inked up into the word language, and this is quite a small thing. It's absurd to see it so large. It's about 4 inches square, 3 inches square. And what you're seeing there is a pocket. Around the exterior, around the edges, it is affixed with a light line of blue, and then it's a wax paper. It's actually literally wax paper, something fancier, that's been printed in front of that. And I printed it, I can move right back in. I printed it with marks of the body, sort of scars, indentations, and these just might suggest the corporal flesh, because I was referencing as corpus, right? So it's a kind of a skin, or a little ravioli, or a little blister, and inside, the text dust that is all the words to define language, letter by letter, is floating around. Right, so all of the letters to define the words that make up the definition of language are trapped in this little ravioli pocket, and they float around. And so here's intuition, and this is a good one to come up to next, because this project, I think, was really about, fundamentally about the insufficiency of words and language alone to explain things to us. So something like intuition, which of course is so nuanced and so idiosyncratic to every individual. I mean, also means that things can be explained in that many letters. I mean, I find that a little bit absurd. So I think that this portrayed or demonstrated to an audience the inadequacy maybe of language alone to sort of make sense of the world or of experience. Again, remember, to be explained in so few letters has some sort of idiocy about it. So while I was cutting these things up, I've installed different ways of grid. It's this line. Now they're kind of busted up. Now I've busted up the set, which is great. I still have some that I really care about, but a lot of them around the world. Okay, so this is the man next, the room next door, as you can tell. And I was really lucky to be able to have that space, I think right after the renovation, if I remember. I think that those beautiful leaded pane glass windows were blocked off for many years during the renovation and opened up for the show. And also, I was the first artist who got to use the atrium, which is great. But I did this project called Beyond Words, which is the first time I thought about illustration. So I switched, or I had a switch in my mindset away from text and towards illustration. So throughout these years, I have been cutting up text. I would come to an illustration or preserve it. So I wouldn't cut through the illustration. So you come to the aardvark or you come to an attaché case. The back of that page is still going to have letters on it. So I could have, you know, kept with my thorough overcutting, but I would save it. I'll just put it this, I didn't think too much about it. But then it occurred to me, what is chosen? You know, when does the dictionary default to imagery? In other words, when are the limits of language found or met? And in order to be thorough about explaining the meaning of something, we have to go to image. Now that's an interesting question. I mean, many of those people in this room are sure artists. So basically, when do we come up to bat kind of thing? So I took this dictionary, and yet another one, I'm sure, at this point, a third one, and I excised, you can see these holes, I removed the illustrations from the dictionary, but left the volume otherwise intact. And critically, just like with this body of work, I left the caption in the dictionary. So it was going to say aardvark, the word aardvark stayed on the page, the word attaché case stayed on the page. So this thing riddled with holes was part of the gallery on install. And then the dictionary illustrations were cut out and mounted on these wall panels in sequence, in order, but they were distant from the words that explained what they meant. And so therefore, viewers were kind of left to decipher and determine meaning for themselves, to decide what things meant without language, you know, there. And sometimes, I mean, yeah, you can go vote in the upper right, something like that, or B, but a lot of them, or not even don't recognize them, but you can't understand. I'm going to say that the letter D back here has basically, you call it sign language behind it, but it's dactology. So you have to go, well, what are they calling this? Like, why is this sign language under letter D? And so there is this sort of sense finding or meaning making that you have to, the viewer has to sort of develop, which I found interesting. I mean, the main questions I was asking were, what was chosen for illustration? And therefore, what was beyond words to explain or to define? And I, you know, I also, I think implicit in that question is, where does experience or other ways of knowing help us, the non-language ways of knowing help us reach understanding and make meaning? So, because there are definitely like these tangible limits to what language can do. So there were 3,000 illustrations glued to the walls. There they are on these panels. This is intriguing, again, just like we're in this room, there's a letter C back there that has a giant constellation on it, and here's why, it takes up half the page of the illustration, so that might come up later if you want to know more about how these things are made. I enlarged everything in this show proportionally. So it, you know, had this almost chapel-like quality to it, for sure, with that a dictionary, you know, poised on that pedestal and that kind of symmetrical and that darkened room, and I get it, I know, I did that thing. Okay, so back here to the letter B. So from that project, I moved more more or less directly into this one, which is, instead of having them individually visible on these panels, what about this compression of knowledge? So the idea of the simultaneity, another way to talk about desire to understand. So letter B here, I don't have the notation of how many letters. This is probably around 200 layers. But you can decipher things. So this is a bicycle, bird beaks, bridges, bandages, and other things, but in the middle it gets really dense. It's because it's just all that's going to happen. A dictionary prints things in columns. So if you enlarge everything proportionally, there's just a likelihood that something that was, an inch and a quarter in the dictionary gets brought out to 15 inches is all, of course, going to hit in the exact same places. But again, I hope that the quality of the printing leaves that residue on the surface that talks about individual moments of action, and that it might encourage you to sort of decipher this thing. So that's the constellation, which was so big in the dictionary, so it took a half of the week. But you got the tail of a cod, you got the castle, you got a shell in there. This is the biggest one, 380 layers. X over there is just two. If I have X on my shelf, okay. There's that dactylology that I mentioned. Drums, dinosaur, only two for the letter X. Letter Y. So I have to admit that I do enjoy them when they are a little bit more open like this. I the idea was just too good to stop, but I mean, it's not as if I think that, letter S here, actually the letter S might have the most, I apologize, 392. The letter S has far too many for even me to, go in there and dig it out. But it had to happen because the idea that drove this, I was so committed to. I really found, as I said in my gallery talk on First Friday, I don't know that I would call these beautiful, and so if you are hesitating to call them beautiful, it's okay. But I think that the idea behind them is where the beauty resides for me. And I do hope, again, that there's this performative action of making that remains in the work. But I have to admit that when they're more open like this and we can make these, we can decipher them and see a yak and see a yacht and see a yellow jacket, that there is, it's more playful and you start to have, it sets up a conversation that isn't cacophony, where the rest of it's cacophony. So I appreciate that. And to the extent that, I'll zoom for a few more. So there's letter Z. Oh, I answered one question, I need to answer it. Right, this is the very last illustration dictionary. People ask, so there you are. Those are Chepel, little tiny cat. And it is printed there as the very last layer. I didn't always print in sequence. So, I can be absurd, but maybe there are limits even for me. So I would actually try to cram as many illustrations as I could onto one screen print. And so I didn't always go methodically, alphabetically through my printing, but I did make the effort to end with Zucchetto. There was some kind of ceremony about that, in which I was the sole audience member. It was important. And here's the thing, I printed this over a 2-year period of time, and I had the fuel for it. I have to say, I could do it tomorrow. I still love these illustrations so much, and I'll talk a little bit in a second about what it is I think that I adore so much, but I put on a podcast, I listened to This American Life, which was a perfect complement because, the stories change every 8 or 12 minutes, and so you're getting a brand new illustration, a new story. You didn't have to have any kind of continuity. So I did that for years, months. And this is why you're sitting in a gallery, so probably less relevant, but that's how I displayed them in a show in Michigan. So this was also going on. So as I mentioned that I do enjoy these ones that are more open, you would just come to some illustrations that were clever or were, I felt like they were speaking to me. Okay, I'm saying, but I felt like this is a treat, this is candy, sugar. So like Zebra and Zebu and the way they fit together like that, I like this. I just would have these little side projects, I call them my B-sides, I had a catalog of this work, so they're my B-sides, and they were just things that I would just have around, and I would just pull a couple, and then I'd return to the work. And I don't know if you consider them playful, but I would typically stick, like this is all letter R's, the words are running up the side there. And why I chose to put them together, sometimes they were like Rebus's little games I was playing with language. Sometimes they were formal associations, just the way that stingray looked on top of that particular kind of, dress was intriguing to me. But these fueled me as well. I mean, they provided a kind of almost whimsy, in the face of some of the work of doing letter P or something like that. So these are the B-sides. There's only one or two copies of these. And that is true. Yeah. Oh man, that cat's great on that camera. Are you kidding? So good. Or not, depends on here, where you stand on these things. Yeah, that's a nice one too. Sorry. Okay, let's talk another little joke. Anybody here a font geek? Oh yeah, you are. So, it's kind of a pendulum, word, image. And so I had been doing images with the Beyond Words and then this project. So I got sucked back into language for a little while and I thought, oh, well, you've just done all of the images in the dictionary. It won't even take you that long to do all of the words because what I have to do is A to Z, really. So I first, though, had to answer the critical question, what font does one use if you're going to print the letters A to Z on top of each other? And this is this little font joke, but I ended up picking Aguirre-Armand, by the way. And here's what I did. You know, because it was like 2014 or 2013, what a girl needs to do is make letterpress type. Because why not? So I actually did this at an Intaglio project as an etched copper plates, and I made A to Z as letters on copper plates. There's the letter J, that's Baskerville. Oh, sorry, that's Garamond font. And they're about 8 inches square, 7 inches square. And then you know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna print them on top of each other. The reason I chose Intaglio is that maybe you can tell from this letter A, if you don't know much about etching, you know, you use an acid to bite into a copper plate, and I photographed this, you know, this raking white, so you can tell the depth. So it was a really quite a thick layer of ink, and I have to say that I was very much influenced by work I had seen of Richard Serres, who had done these gorgeous basalt etchings. He had drawn, or I guess drawn, painted these simple images of the rock in the back, you know, basalt. I'm saying it wrong in public, right? And they were just these super dense things. It would take a pound of ink at a time to print, and they were the papers sagging, but they were so rich within the black. There was all these layers, much like what I'm enjoying here. So I wanted to emulate that, but I did it with lettering. So that's why I picked etching rather than screen printing, was I could really exaggerate the depth and the intensity of the ink deposit more than I was really willing to do on 3,000 illustrations and the amount of copper, not even butte to handle that. So here we go, that's close up. And again, I'm photographing it with the advantage of raking light, but the letters do stand off each other, and this is, you know, an accumulation. There's that great Q, that's why I picked Garamond, things like that. And so again, against the light on the etching press, and then finally that's all of them together. And I printed them from Z towards A, just to, you know, if you really want to geek out with me, so that it starts with A on top. So it's called all, just as simple, this one's called All Letters, so that one's not too fancy. Okay, so after all of this stuff, let's talk about what I might have learned. Yeah, we're doing well. Okay. So I realized after all this stuff, there's a persistence to what I'm doing, most certainly. I'm about to go back a little further in time and forward to what I was even doing this afternoon, just to sort of show how much these things can really burrow into your mind. And this is kind of what you do as an artist. You sort of make the same thing over and over again. I mean, yes, it looks a little different than that, I mean, literally, but you kind of chase the same scent for a long time. So I realized that I design art-making actions that repeat, art makeup that helps. They produce material evidence of and from that action. So in this case, we just came off of those layers of oil-based etching ink with these screen prints. So this is what I mean. I mean, there's this residue, this evidence for you, the viewer, to try to follow back this breadcrumb trail for how I started. And there's somewhat ritualistic, let's put a line through that. They're incredibly ritualistic in their repetition and process. They're incremental in execution, and I think that goes to my interest in time, in this notion of a pacing. And I did all this printing myself, and that was really important, not just a sort of faux heroism of it, but I wanted you, as a viewer, to think, how long that might have taken, you know, how many seconds, and what's that like, how does that relate to heartbeats and the passage of the sun in the sky. I mean, there's a way to understand the division of time through labor that I think is interesting. And we share, you know, we can share some of that. So that increment in execution is really important. And then ultimately devise their own metric for showing the division of time. I think I just addressed that, which is the how long does it take for me to pull that? It's not the same as 42 seconds, because that's sort of an arbitrary invented thing anyway. It's a different metric for dividing up my life and, you know, our lives. So I think these are some of the things that I learned after a few years. So how long have I been at these things? This is from about 1991. I was an undergrad, and my very best friend had her grandma passed away, and we went to help her in mid-state New York to pack up actually her grandma's house. We did this like one January. I went to Maryland State College while in Baltimore. And so I had the month of January off, and up I trekked to New York, and she has encyclopedias, 1880, 1900, 1910, about every 10 years I had collected a full set of encyclopedias, and they were so gorgeous. And at first, our best friend is Jill, at first Jill and I were quite tentative, we're like, oh my gosh, that map. You know, and they would call it East Pakistan, East India, you know, the old maps, like, that were interesting to me because they were about political divisions, you know, that weren't current, and I thought, oh, could we just, well, we might, and we just delicately tear it out and put it to the side, right? This was about day one. Day three, day four, it was like this kind of reckless, like, pulling and grabbing, you know, whatever we wanted, because they were just going, they were just going to the dump anyway. So again, this, I hadn't thought about it, at least, you know, this is just some of the pages, but this kind of, a source material that is so much like a dictionary that just screams to me knowledge, learning, you know, information. I was fascinated by it from art, you know, from the time of art school, and no doubt probably even before that. So you want to know how long I've been at this? Quite a while. So you know, this taxonomy of object, the grid, all of that, you know, is embedded. I think it is. I think the sense of learning and knowledge and meaning is embedded just in the characteristic of the mark and the way it's organized. And that is, I said this in my talk before, so I'll say it again, it's like catnip to me. I'll chase that thing down. So these are some of the pages that I ripped out. I still have them. In fact, I was photographing these last night. Just to tell you, I can still put my hand on it if you're watching my house. I know exactly where it was. And so these are engravings because they're made about 1900, but there is this correlation between printmaking as visual communication, because this is proto-photography, you know, this is before we had photographs. Even though we have photographs now, we still illustrate things because there's this reductive line quality to it, the black and white. That's why I mentioned, why could I tomorrow show up and print more of these, is because I'm still charmed by the quality of illustration, because I know that that is a tidbit of something I can learn and hold, hopefully, in my brain. And so when I see this style, it carries meaning. Even before it depicts a water wheel or a balloon, a hot air balloon, I already know it's meant to teach me something. It's contextless. I mean, there's always, of course, the diagrammatic lettering, the arrows, all that stuff is what I seek to retain. So one of the things I wanted to address tonight is that I'm not manipulating these. I enlarge them, but otherwise I do photomechanical processes. So it's not about the luscious mark that I might be able to draw with my hand or paint with color. I mean, they're obviously stripped of color. I don't make this easy on you to like them. But what I'm doing is sort of preserving that source material from beginning right through to through its execution, you know, through my re-execution of it. I don't want to tamper with it because I want to retain that kind of code of knowledge so that you go, oh yeah, that's not a smudgy Rembrandt. Okay, so when I was undergrad, what I did with them, shockingly familiar, is I put them together into like these collage-like forms, and I made a scroll. I made a blueprint, actually. It was about 60 feet long, 2 feet wide, and it was just these images that I had put together. I wasn't as, John is so complimentary to me about sort of my conceptual rigor now. I mean, I was a kid, and I didn't necessarily have, a lot of this was visually based. It wasn't so rigorous in terms of how I was combining things. But I do think that it was a smart move, you know, to use the blueprint. So that's how long you can have these ideas. You can be persistent for a long time. Another thing that I've done with the dictionary, I'll speak about these things briefly, is I have also thought about subsets within the dictionary. So there were 44 different knots. Maritime stuff was super important in 1966, still, as it turns out. So I collected all the knots, and I printed them out, and I began to collage them together to make a mega knot. I didn't change the scale of them. I did allow myself to cut them. So, like, for instance, let's say this bow right here, I mean, I cut that out and I sort of scooted that into this other form and this little knot. I mean, so there were things that I allowed myself to do in terms of manipulation and layering, but I didn't distort, I guess. And there's some sense of honor about that one. You don't care, but I do. So this is all the knots like all the letters, all the knots, and I thought about, I intended in the beginning to make like a, I want to make a mating ball of snakes, you know how they the mating, I want to make a mating ball of knots. And of course this is a story, and it's a story about trying to figure something out, and knots are a puzzle that we need to untie, right, to understand something. But I didn't quite make a mating ball, but I did make this other shape. And then I screen printed it, I actually flocked it, and I'm installing it. So it's a pretty large, well, it's much larger, but it's actually a light blue. It's hard to tell in this photo, sorry, but it's so similar to that blueprint now that I think about it. Oh yeah, I've been doing that a long time. All the bricks, it turns out. There are six styles of bricks. You have three down the right, you have one, two, three on the left. And of course, you know, brick walls are barriers, brick walls are things that you need to get beyond. And I had this idea that I would make like a post-it note stack of them. I did, I used actually the kind of glue used for post-it notes. So I photocopied them, enlarged them. They're glued across the top. And what was super important to me was that this was the side edge. I can't tell you exactly why, but the visual kind of communication of that line running down meant that, of course, it was consistent from top to bottom, and no matter how many of these you tore off, and viewers are encouraged to tear them off, and then no matter how many you tore off, you were basically going to hit another wall. And so they were both a paper tie, where they were this sort of very lightweight thing that you could discard super easily, but it was persistent, it kept coming back, and I mean, you could get to the end of it, thank goodness no viewers ever have, I still have it, but they were sort of carefully cut out and pieced back together. There was about 150 of each of them. They're just Xerox, it's nothing too fancy. It wasn't screen print or etching or anything. But this is the line that was really important to me. So I've done that. I've done these things that entertain me as I do those other really long projects. Okay, so we'll get to that. So now I'm going to finish. I'm going to finish it. And I will say that I want to add one other thing prior to this final one. I forgot to mention, which is just the notion of the photomechanical reproduction. Part of it is the de-emphasis of the artist's hand. The notion that I don't want to intervene into this imagery because I want it to retain the characteristics of knowledge, that code of learning. I want that to stay right through to the time you see it. The other thing I have to admit to myself is I also think that there is a desire on my behalf to not have knowledge change so much. You know, this sort of sentiment, this kind of bittersweet quality. I mean, I make the text that moves in the little blister pack. I get it. Knowledge changes all the time. There's nothing that is fixed. I mean, I can say those words and I know it. But in, you know, in your heart, you kind of want things to not change so much. You sort of want something to stay the same. Part of that, I think, is knowledge. You want to think, yeah, I could learn everything because it's fixed. I could just plot away and get there. I think another part of it is, of course, the sense of just maybe liking what you have and wishing for not to go away. Like, this too shall pass. You really don't want that to be accurate. I know it is. But I think part of why I also use these photomechanical processes and not let imaging change, especially knowledge images change, is that I kind of have this bittersweet desire to not have knowledge change. So I kind of have to admit that in public. Okay, so over the, this is a funny one to pause on. I'm going forward. Oh, no. There we go. We'll go back to this. So in the midst of these now almost 15 years I've worked with the dictionary, things have changed about how we find knowledge and where we seek out sources of information. Turning to the dictionary as a book with pages that one turns is less and less common. I mean, you might ask, how do I find knowledge or meaning? I go to Wikipedia just like everybody does. And so I've struggled since I finished this body of work, which was 2012-2013, I've actually struggled a little bit to try to find a way to move on, continue to investigate meaning and the conveyance of knowledge, but admit or acknowledge that this source material is losing relevance. And so I did these little projects that kept me busy, the knots and the bricks, it's all good. I was busy. But I've struggled, I think, to figure out how to basically deal with the digital world and almost instant transfers of information. And actually, knowledge that really starts to lack context. And knowledge that definitely does not stay fixed. So I can engage 3,000 illustrations, I'm willing to go there. But for me to talk about what Wikipedia has in terms of the amount of pictures or a Google image search for aardvark and how many images that would pull up, you know, 28,000, 144,000, I'm not that crazy. And tomorrow, anyway, it's going to be 142,000, and the next day, 164,000, so I can't catch up regardless. Also, I don't yet, I haven't yet discovered maybe inappropriate or an eloquent metaphor for digital imaging, meaning layering and this kind of reflective surface quality and this density is a metaphor here for the passage of time. And I haven't yet really found one in the digital realm that is effective for me, you know, that has that maybe a little bit of that bittersweet quality of cut up text and is directly from the material, right? So I mean, it has to come directly from material because that's my rigor, and I need it to be a little romantic, but rich. I need it to be eloquent. And I haven't, I've been struggling, I think, to find that. So I started something this summer that I'm gonna premiere here, and it'll be in the faculty show, fingers crossed, in a couple weeks, that might be an overture into that, and that's what I keep getting to hear. Okay, this is 256 squares. Quantity, labor, we still got that. I can go back to my list of things and make sure I'm checking them off. This is gonna be about 16 feet because each of these blocks is about 6 inches. And I picked 256 because it's this base code of imagery in the digital world. There's 256 levels. It's just an algorithm that's necessary sort of to undergird digital imaging, just like columns in a dictionary or an engraved line is the kind of scaffolding of knowledge in a dictionary. There's a scaffolding of knowledge, that's called, or code that underscores the digital imaging world, and it's 256, and it's this reductive palette, and it's the pixel. So this is the landscape, and I'm a little uncertain. I have two images I'll show you that I'm working on. This is a landscape, and specifically, it is the field behind my house where I grew up. Okay, so there's a Smarty Pants Elizabeth that took over, like I talked about. The Smarty Pants Elizabeth took over, and I was gonna go, oh, I'm gonna do like Gutenberg's press. I'll do like a pixelized image of Gutenberg's press, because that's knowledge. I'm like, man, that's too clever, throw that out. I went through a couple of these things, you know, I was gonna do, like I was in conversation with art history or some kind of reference point. Like basically, what is the image that I was gonna use for this reductive pixelization? Instead, I found that I went back to my own source material, which isn't that uncommon, and I picked this landscape with this location behind the house I grew up, which was a dense forest, and, you know, this kind of a story about how something looked so far away when you were little, you know, yeah, it's that story. The story is so far away and so big, and then you go back as an adult and you're like, oh, I could have thrown a stone and hit those trees, sort of. It was about 50 yards from my back of my home. But the landscape, when you went inside, it was totally different. It was. I grew up in Maryland. It was hot and humid in the summer. But you went in there, it was dense pine forest. It was cool and moist and shady. And there were like this evidence of, you know, teenagers doing teenager things that was sort of illicit. And oh, what's that? And there's this, you know, there was the fox that lived in there and nests and things. So it was a very rich place of experience for me. So I picked that, somehow that's right, this sort of intersection of this very kind of logical way of approaching the world and asking questions, and this kind of experiential way. That intersection was interesting. And what I'm doing with these is I am making them into pixels that are about 6 inches squared, and you can probably tell I'm printing them pixel by pixel onto dictionary pages. So this is why I think it's a transition, not why. It is a transition for what I'm doing here, because I'm still sort of pointing the viewer to thinking about codes of meaning and codes of understanding. And you know, maybe I just need that basis. Maybe it's just comforting to me as well. And so I'm printing them onto like a plastic, and then I'm gonna mount them on the wall. So that's what I'm working on now. And then this is the second image, also 256, I'm doing as a square. And this is a pile. This is not one of those piles that was in my house when I was growing up. This is just a pile. But it's a notion of accumulation, it's a notion of kind of a burden of information, which I think is consistent with a lot of what I've done. It's interesting to work with something so pictorial, you know? So, you know, after doing something so reductive here, it's still working, let's be honest. But I'm looking, I guess, for an appropriate metaphor to exploit from the digital world. And I don't know if this is the end of it, but that's where I have been led most recently. Yeah, so that's, I guess, what I have for you. That's my breadcrumb trail. I'm happy to answer any further questions. I can slow down and anything you need if you have such questions. And thank you for your attention. Okay. Yes, sir?
Elizabeth, you said there was 3,000 illustrations?
Yeah, there were.
So I'm curious, do you have any idea how many people worked on those?
Well, that is interesting. In the front of the dictionary, so there's many pages before I would start cutting up. You know, when I was cutting up page by page, I had to begin with the sort of colophon in front and the dedication to the publisher. I didn't cut that up. I started with letter A, you know, the first AAA word. But in the front, they credit all these sources. So there's these credits for sources for things like marine knots. I mean, there's somebody who would be an expert in knots. There's somebody who's an expert in chemistry, somebody an expert in women's fashion. I can't tell you how many sort of haircuts and shoes that were strange things. So all these credits for those expertise, PhDs, all of these things, not a single notation of the illustrators, which I think is just negligent. There certainly were more than one, because even from what I showed in the early ones, there was like the image of the anvil, if you can recall that. It had a kind of a dense, kind of vertical line, and then there was the image of the attaché case, simple outline. Both of them, I think, were very reductive, but one of them was just physically denser, and I don't know what, here, maybe this is, would be an example right here that everyone can see, like the whale tail has this kind of linear structure that the windmill doesn't. And so I know that there were different voices, just different, you know, artists whose voices were seen in this. There's zero credit.
That was the second part to my question, is if you could start to tell the difference after working with all of them, and apparently you can. You could see, because I think it's interesting, because you're kind of removing the hand.
Yeah.
But then, as you go through this, you can still...
Yeah, right, so there is personality in it, I would agree, and style. Yeah. And from what I can tell, it wasn't as if the individual who drew with that linear thing, a whale, had some particular expertise in zoology. Sure. I just think that ended up on his desk that day. It really, I guess that my assumptions here and also the lack of credit in the dictionary both indicate that there's a disregard for that skill set. And I mean, I don't know that I hope that wouldn't linger today. I imagine that we have a different relationship to sourcing now, although if you think about maybe not, maybe that's actually kind of a ridiculous thing for me to say when you think about how the contextlessness of how images fly around the web now, and they're just completely divorced, you know. Pinterest is fun to sort of look at things, but you have no idea what you're gonna do. What the heck, where did that start? You know, it seems that kind of nutty. And I do, well, I won't answer a question that hasn't been asked. Other questions?
Maybe I missed this because I was a little tardy. Did you photo etch each plate, and then did you do like 392 plates for that? And
should I tell what I should? Because I have more respect than my photos. I did it. And they're screen prints.
Okay.
So each of them was done individually, and they were done from the direct source, but they were screen prints, so a way faster process, because I could gang up multiple images on one screen, and the cost of it, and basically recycle the screen every day. So I could maybe squish five or six images on a screen, and I'd have five screens on the go. I'd print all day. At the end of the day, I would reclaim them and prepare them for the next day. So there were some very sort of logical things I had to do to just afford this, because I aimed for making 15 of each of these prints. So when you're doing 15 of Q, I probably have 15 of Q because there's not very many illustrations, but 15 of letter S at 392 layers became impossible. So I ended up with 8 complete sets of all of them, and those are in box, they're being boxed as they're being sold. The MAM has one, which will end up in its collection, which Anapis said, interestingly, but another one. And photo etching would have just been ridiculously expensive. And also, there's like the issues of the sort of resources at that, where I think about how much paper I went through on these, and it is a little nauseating, you know, on one level, even though you just do that idea, it just pulls you forward all the time. Yeah, you will. Here we go. Matt Hammond. I'm bracing for it. I joke because my colleague is a wise individual who asks tough questions, so good softball, sir.
I don't think this is tough, but I'm curious about what Edward Tufte would think. And data visualization, as visual artists, I feel like we have faith that the image or the idea is enough. And then in data visualization, there's faith that the data and the arrangement of it will create some kind of epiphany. So in this arrangement of the data, were there epiphanies that might have emerged, or would Tufte just write this off as kind of mud?
He probably would, in the sense that I think, so Edward Tufte is probably the most well-known data visualization, data visualizer. He's a designer, artist, statistician who has spent probably about 30 or 40 years both doing data visualization and theorizing and writing about it. And I think that the kind of his guiding star is clarity, is the idea that data and all these numbers, and that it's hard for us to view that and reach conclusions. To actually, we drown in numbers, we drown in information. And so Tufte and data visualization is often about revealing something very concisely, communicating very rapidly through well-designed images. Okay? This would probably not fit those standards. In a sense, it's almost the opposite. I've actually probably created the thing that then the dictionary would need to unpack and kind of lay out horizontally almost. That said, I do think, I do hope anyway, and I do believe that it does convey the not just the essence of visualization as if, oh, I made a thing that kind of sounds and smells like data. But I mean, I do think, I mean, it is data, it is incremental in execution, and it is complete, right? But it's not, you're not reaching, and so I think the conclusions you're reaching probably by seeing that are, you know, things that I am interested in, like the desire to figure it out and to decipher it. But you're not, it's clarity is not one of those conclusions you're reaching. So in that sense, I think you'd probably be somewhat horrified, or you would just disregard it. You would probably just dismiss it pretty quickly. I met the man once, and he can dispense with things. Is that okay? What do you think? Would you agree?
I think maybe the epiphanies would be more poetic, right? Mm-hmm. And that's likely what visual artists get at, and that maybe the data doesn't.
Yeah, and so that intersection of poetic data is pretty intriguing. He actually is a visual artist himself, and I have to say, I would have a few harsh things to say at his piece here about his art. What are you going to do that later? So, other questions out there? Okay, well, that was lovely. Thanks for your attention. I appreciate it.